talk today again on free oscillation of the Earth, but I will talk only on the Schlichter mode. And in fact, in the Earth, you have three modes related to the presence of the solid inner core, and these three modes have never been detected, or maybe. Oh, sorry. So I will talk about the Schlichter mode, which is a mode which has never been detected. I will not talk about the free inner commutation, which has not really been detected either. And I will not talk about the inner core wobble, which has not yet been detected, even if there is one paper suggesting a possible detection, but it's controversial. So I will focus on the Schlichter mode, which I have already mentioned 2 days ago. So All the story of this Schlichter mode started with a publication by Schlichter in 1961, where he showed that after the large earthquake in Chile in 1960, where you can recognize here the seismic mode that have been clearly observed, he showed that there was a peak here with a period close to 86 minutes that he couldn't explain, and he suggested that this peak could be related to an oscillation of the inner core. But, so what is the Schlichter mode? It's, if you remember, it's a spheroidal mode of degree harmonic 1, which corresponds to a translational oscillation of the center of mass of the inner core in the fluid core, but because of the rotation of the Earth and ellipticity, the mode is split into three singlets. So this is what we call it Schlichter triplet. So you have one mode which is said to be which is axial, corresponding to m equals zero, and you have two modes which are in the equatorial plane related to the harmonic order m equals minus one and m equals plus one. So one mode is what we say prograde, so it means follows the rotation of the Earth, and the other one is retrograde because it's a controversy to the rotation of the Earth. So after the publication by Schlichter, people have tried to explain this mode. So the first numerical evidence of its existence was suggested by Alsop in 1963, where he already introduced the notion of degenerate spheroidal triplet. Then, sorry, I cannot breathe with the mask, in fact. then, Buss in 1974 computed the equation for the oscillation of a rigid sphere inside an inviscid fluid. And he suggested already at that time that this oscillation could be excited by some pressure fluid motion inside the outer core. Then in 1976, Smith proposed the Eigen solution in the case of a rotating and slightly elliptical Earth model. And after we got some numerical estimate of the frequency and of this mode by Dallen and Seller in 1979 and Kosler and some other study, who suggested that its period should be between 4 and 6 hours. And it is now admitted that for a prime model, it's close to 5.42 hours. So there is also other theoretical studies after that to try to estimate more specifically its period. There was some suggestion that the hydrostatic flattening of the Earth could make this period even larger than what is obtained with prime model. Then there was a study that computed the influence of the presence of a Mercy zone at the inner core boundary. And Peng shows that the presence of a Mercy zone at the inner core boundary could have a small influence on the period, but still small, but it could be even larger than some other parameter of the Earth, like elasticity of the mantle, or stratification of outer core and ellipticity. And in fact, it shows that its period will be higher if we have a Mercier zone, will be 0.6% higher than for a prime model if there is a Mushi zone of 5 kilometer thickness. Then there was some theoretical study by Evrogister who has shown that the period should decrease with the compressibility of the outer core. And more recently, there was a paper, a study by Greenfell and Wisdom, who have shown that the presence of fast transformation could reduce the period of this mode to even minutes, so very much shorter. And indeed, here it's an example. To show that since you have a solid inner core which is oscillating in a fluid, the main feedback mechanism is the Archimedean force. And so the frequency of this mode will be directly proportional to the density jump between the solid inner core and the fluid outer core at the inner core boundary. So this is what is represented here. It's the value of the period of this Sichter mode, or I would say, Sichter mode, with respect to the density jump at the inner core boundary. So you see that the period is decreasing when the density jump is increasing. And also, if we compute the influence, we can also check the influence of the compressibility of the outer core on this period. This is what is represented here. You can see that the period is decreasing when the compressibility of the outer core is increasing. And here it's the value for the prime model. And after the first suggestion by Sichter of the existence of this mode, some people have claimed about detection of this triplet of frequency. They use for that a supergrating gravimeter data, so time varying gravity variation observed at the Earth's surface, and from a product spectrum of four time series, they have claimed to have detected three peaks, which are indicated by the arrow here, and they say that's the Sichter triplet. Okay, personally, I'm not convinced when I see this kind of stuff. But after that, they made several papers to build some new theory related based on this unique observation, which was more or less confirmed by other people from the same group using nearly same data sets. Okay, so based on this triplet of frequency, they have even proposed that the viscosity of the outer core should be very large, 10 to 11 Pascal second, which is when we usually it's rather 10 to minus 2 from lab experiments, and since you know that it's like more like water than such value, it's quite large. And they did not consider the presence of a Mushi zone for this value. Yes? Not the outer core moves away, but the mantle is slightly shifted to conserve the center of mass of the Earth, but it's very, very small on Earth. Okay, it's negligible. The inner core is moving one way, and the mantle is slightly in the other way, but since the mantle is very large, it's very small. But on Mercury, it's the displacement of the mantle is quite is not negligible. So it's a displacement of the center of the inner core, yes. But it's in 3D, so it's, the center of mass inner core is a translational motion. But in fact, if you consider particle trajectory, it will be ellipsoidal. I didn't put any picture, I should have, sorry. but it's a translational oscillation of the center of mass of the inner core. So this claim detection was based on data records from time-varying gravity fields that are continuously recorded at the Earth's surface. So just for your information, there are currently an international network of supercomputing gravimeters, so that's the gravimeter that was used to for this detection. And just so that you know, there is a network of this instrument. So this is this supercomputing gravimeter. In fact, there are relative gravimeters, so they measure the time variation of the gravity field. And there are currently the instruments which are the most precise to detect modes at such low frequency. They perform even better than long period seismometer at frequency below 1 millihertz. And so the principle of measurement from this gravimeter is that you have a niobium sphere which is levitating in a magnetic field. And when the gravity is changing, the current is induced, is injected in coils, and to bring back the sphere at the original position. So that's what we measure. So the advantage of such magnetic feedback is that it's very stable in time. So the drift is very small. I don't know if you already know what is, or you already heard about gravimeter, but other gravimeter, relative gravimeters, are using a spring feedback. So there is a large drift. In this case, we don't have such a drift, so that's one advantage. And that's the lowest noise levels we can have below 1 millihertz. And particularly at the period of the Schlichter mode, around 5 hours. That's why this instrument, I mean, the time records of this instrument were used to try to detect this mode. And in fact, since the development of this instrument in the 90s, there have been many people trying to reproduce the claimed observation by the Canadian group, and French, American, Chinese, myself, Taiwanese, and so on, and even recently in 2019. So more than 25 years of search for this mode, but all these people, we couldn't find any mode, even using more data sets and less noisy data sets. And even it was shown that, particularly by Rutter in 2000, that such an observation is contrary to incompatible with recent theoretical development. So since it was never detected, we can ask why, what would be the surface amplitude, or is the surface amplitude of this mode will depend on the excitation process, but also on the damping mechanism. And some studies have quantified the damping by anelasticity, and they show that the creative factor associated with this mode should be very large, around 5,000. So this is based on the seismological theory of anelasticity. And some people have checked if the viscosity could be a damping mechanism, but no, it's because viscosity is small, and so they obtain a quality factor very large. So I just remember, the larger the quality factor, the less the mode is damped. And the magnetic damping also was suggested to be very small. So we can assume that the quality factor is quite large for this mode. So weak damping. So what will be the excitation process for such oscillation of the inner core? So the first idea that comes in mind, of course, it's earthquakes. So, but also we could consider what are with pressure flow acting at the core boundaries. Just for fun also, I have looked at the impact of a meteorite. And also atmospheric surface pressure load could act as an excitation mechanism. So, but the eigenfunction of this degree one moon are very small in terms of radial displacement and tangential displacement or potential variation at the surface. So we expect that the amplitude will be very small. And in fact, just remember from the eigenfunction, if we can compute the Green function, and from the eigenfunction of the mode, we can compute Green function and convolute with any force that would apply to the Earth. So that's what we did for seismic excitation. So this is expected amplitude of this of the Schlichter mode in terms of perturbation of the gravity field. So just to remember, one nanogal correspond to 10 to the minus 12 little g, where g is the mean gravity field value at the surface of the Earth. And so we see that, for instance, for the largest Chile event in 1960, which was the event that was used by Schlichter to propose the existence of this mode, we see that the surface amplitude in terms of perturbation of gravity is about 1.5 nanogal. And for other more recent earthquakes, like the Sumatra and Daman in 2004, we see that the perturbation of gravity field at the surface is about 0.3 nanogal, corresponding to, in fact, to a surface vertical displacement of about 1 micrometer. So it's very, very small. And so what, in fact, I forgot to say that 1 nanogal is the limit of detection we have with the supergravitational gravimeters. So that's why 1 nanogal is target level of amplitude we would like to have. Yes? Little g, yes.
Ah, okay.
Little g, yes. Okay. Yes. And so which amplitude, which magnitude of earthquake we will need to reach 1 nanogal in terms of surface perturbation of the gravity field? In fact, we can with a simple model, we can show that we will need at least 9.7. So hopefully we don't have such a large event.
Hmm?
Not here, no. The North Pole. Okay, so also what would be the amplitude after large meteorite impact? So using the parameter we know about some past impact that have been inferred from existing craters on the Earth, we can try to compute the magnitude energy corresponding with such impact and see how much we will excite the Schlichter mode and what will be the amplitude at the Earth's surface. So that's what I did here, just to show that for the largest meteorite impact at Chicxulub in Mexico, it would correspond to a magnitude 9.6 earthquakes that would induce gravity perturbation at the order of 0.67 nanogal. So it's still less than 1 nanogal. Yeah, that's what is here. So, yes. But of course, in this computation, there is some uncertainty due to the conversion of the impact velocity into seismic energy. So, just approximative. So just to summarize the various sources of excitation for this mode. So in red, that's excitation of the oscillation of the inner core by atmospheric surface pressure load. When you have the atmosphere has a very large spectral contents, and even at the degree one of spatial scales, it's a very large source of energy. And this is the amplitude of this mode for different global model of atmospheric pressure load we have on Earth. So in red here. And in black, this is earthquakes, the induced gravity effect for mini earthquakes. In blue, that's for artificial pressure flow acting at the inner core boundary, because we don't know what are the amplitude of the flow at such time scales and acting at the inner core boundary. So that's just subjective numbers that I put to estimate the amplitude of the effect. And here it's a detection level, so 1 nanogal here. And we see, for instance, that 1 pascal degree 1 flow, or here it's at the Coromantan boundary. Yes, acting at the Coromantan boundary, but you can convert it at the inner core boundary, there is a conversion. So if we have 1 pascal of flow, degree 1 flow around 5 hours, we could reach 1 nanogal of surface gravity perturbation. But the problem is that, yes, we don't know what are the pressure flow at this time scale. But we can, since we have never detected the Schlichter mode, we can infer that it should be smaller than that. So just to conclude on the Schlichter mode, so the maximum surface gravity perturbation we can expect from the oscillation of the inner core is less than 1 nanogal. so below the limit of detection of the current instrument we have. And the largest amplitude will be for pressure flow acting at the inner core boundaries. The effect of fast transformation has been studied once, but not in a very realistic way. So that's something that would be interesting to check again. And also something interesting that has never been done yet, it's to study the coupling of this Schlichter mode with some gravito-inertial modes that could exist depending on the the stratification of the core and so that. But I have one hope to maybe detect this mode one day, is that physicists are building some new gradiometers that may be very sensitive enough to detect the inner core oscillation. So there is still a challenge here in terms of observability of inner core signal. Thank you. Yeah, of course. Yeah. That's the first thing to try. Ah, no, because many things have been tried. Some what, sorry?
Some
modes
of the sun.
Of the sun?
Ah,
you mean the it's S1, S2, and so on. Yeah. But it's we see them, but it's at different. We know their frequency very well, so that's why we can say it's not a Schlichter mode because we know it's. Yes. Yes. Exactly. Yeah. Yes. Yes. Exactly. Yes. But at higher frequency. But in fact, in the MIGA project that I started a few years ago, where they want to build two laser cardiometer, they expect to go down to smaller frequency. But initially, it was planned to go below to these frequencies. But because of less funding, finally they make the length shorter. So I'm afraid we will not be able to go so down in frequency. But maybe new instrument with the Einstein telescope, maybe I don't know yet. Yes. I didn't.
The
LBI. What? But VLBI. For displacement, VLBI is not good. You have all the displacement due to surface loading effect and things like that. In terms of displacement, it's. I mean, if you want to look displacement, first it's GPS that should be used, not VLBI. Yeah, but VLBI VLBI is not good for displacement. It's I have not yet looked at string meter data. I don't know. Yeah, that's true. Yes. But I don't know what would be the amplitude in string. I'm not sure it should be. I didn't compute it. It's something in my to-do list. Theoretically, it's.
Well, I mean, except if, for example, there is translation, convex translation.
Yes.
Are we sure it didn't have this kind of
translation? You mean because of crystallization?
The phase change, it could affect the oscillation.
But the oscillation is much faster than.
Sure.
something I have been wondering also for some time. And in fact, the only things I look it's compare the speed of translation with respect to, I don't know, from the dendritic growth, for instance.
Mm-hmm.
But I never looked at some bulk crystallization that would be associated with the displacements. I never did it yet. I didn't do it.
Yeah, I would believe also it would be different.
I don't think so. It's very fast here. It's if you crystallize, but they use an instantaneous phase change model, and they did some and they but if you have crystallization, your inner core will go in fact less far from the initial point, so your feedback will be smaller. So no, it will be stronger. Sorry. So you will have a higher frequency and smaller period. Yeah, it's very small whatsoever. It's millimeter displacement of the inner core, so at most millimeter. So. Yeah, even in terms of rotation, I mean, it's 1,400 smaller than inertia of the Earth. So
I guess there are other planets where
Mercury. Yes, Mercury would be possible, yes. Mm.
So are there plans of trying to measure that?
We need data for that.
Yeah, I know. Are there plans to get the data?
Mercury has an inner core?
I mean, there are some models where
with inner core, yeah. Yeah, it's serious. Yeah. But it's just subjective values, yeah.
Because if we just take 1 millimeter per second, which is quite high already, then it would be like more 10 minus 2 and half of rho u squared, 10 minus 2 Pascal.
Uh-huh,
so
yeah.
But in the core, the magnetic energy is more than the kinetic energy.
Mm-hmm.
So it would not be, it would be dynamical in a sense, but not due to the inertia or something, but maybe to the magnetic
Lorentz. I never tried that, yeah. But they cannot provide me with the degree one.
Yeah.
And not the pressure, not nothing at the ICB. Problem of balance of force, I don't understand very well, but you need to know the balance of forces and consider all the same.
Well, we can do it in principle, but we have never done it, but there's no impossibility, I think.
Mm-hmm.
But in the end, you have to scale the things and
yeah.
You get some dimensional stuff, you scale them.
Mm.
The order of magnitude calculation will be the same value. I mean,
yeah. so yeah, it's very fast here. 5 hours for yeah, that's also another thing.
No, 5 hours. But well, give me a bigger confusion. No,
yeah.
we need to resolve time shorter than the day.
Yeah, yeah.
5 hours shorter than the day, not much shorter. But not so complicated to me.
Yeah, you mentioned this detection of the mode at the 6 minute period. So
I don't know what it is. And nobody, I did not find anything in the literature about it. So, artifact of signal processing, I don't know. No idea. There is nothing known. No. Because the smallest mode, seismic mode, is 54 minutes, so 86, I don't know.